Welcome viewers. Today we are going to do chapter 2, which is Methods of Inquiry in Psychology. Today we are going to study survey research method and psychological testing method. Survey research method you will definitely study in economics and all the other subjects as well. Now this method, particularly in psychology, tries to understand various opinions, attitudes and factual data. Like when you talk about and when you look at exit polls during elections, before elections, that time parties are trying to identify and news channels are trying to identify which party is going to win. That is happening when you collect a sample, when you try and identify a particular group of people, some regions you try and approach, and you give them a set of questions or you ask them questions. Another could be when a product is being launched in the market. Before launching a product, let's say wants to launch different flavors. Before launching their flavors, they would want to know which flavors are already available and which flavors could be added. What do people want? So basically, research in survey basically tries to identify different opinions, attitudes. So attitude could be attitude related to marriage. Different opinions related to different topics, again different factual data, that is what survey about the government, factual data. Let's look at the types of survey here. Types are basically the different kinds of interview. Through interview, surveying could be done, personal face-to-face interaction where in-depth information is being collected. Now, interview method is a very direct method. Interview can happen in two forms, structured and unstructured manner. Structured is also known as standardized and the other is unstandardized. Structured is basically when a fixed set of questions are there. Unstructured, when the questions are happening in a random order. In a viva, in a science viva, the questions are not fixed. A particular child can be asked anything. That is unstructured or unstandardized. Structured is when a simple questionnaire is given to you, you have to fill it up like a feedback form where fixed questions are there. Everybody is answering the same kind of questions. That is structured. The advantage is this is very closed-ended. There's a uniformity. Everybody answers in the same manner. The other one is not uniform, but it is very rich in information that it collects because the information that comes out is very detailed and the clarification of doubtful answers and questions can also be done. That is the types of preparation, structured or unstructured. In structured, the preparation is that the questions are set first, which are uniform. Unstructured, it is asked from whatever set of questions are there without any fixed order or sequence of fixed answers. Another type apart from the interview. Now, in interview, we've already considered the types of questions. Also, we have the types of groups, the data and the sample. We have, it could be one individual with another one, interviewer interviewing the interviewee. It could be also individual to group, one person in front of a group, which is also known as focus group discussion. We can also have a group panel interviewing one person, that can be an interview. And the interview can happen, let's say in a school you have houses, one house versus the other, that is group to group. That is the different kinds of interviewing that you have. And we can also have questionnaires which can be mailed to people. You get also telephonic surveys could be there. You get calls from, let's say, call centers who ask you whether you have need a certain kind of credit card. That can be a telephonic survey. They try and find out how many people use their credit card, which people don't, or a certain network or a certain phone connection. That is a telephonic survey. So in a lot of surveys, you are getting a phone call and you are asked about certain opinions about a certain political aspect. That is a telephonic survey. You get a phone call and you have to reply on that. Now, that is very confidential because your number is being given through your telephone company, through your network company. Your name is given, your detail is given. But obviously, the person, these people do not know you. So you can definitely answer in a very confidential manner. That is a telephonic survey. So questionnaires can be mailed to you. It will depend on you whether you return back or not. So these are done in mass numbers where lots of questionnaires are mailed. People may respond, people may not respond. So that is the kind of interviewing that is done. okay, we just left with one. Let's quickly wind up the advantages, disadvantages, since we've been doing for all of them. Advantage, it's a very good method because you get a lot of data. It's very large data that you get in limited amount of time. You get a bulk of data, and it's of course very quick process as well, quick to conduct, quick to carry out. It's very accurate at times in its predictions, but there might be a problem in the disadvantage aspect. We'll consider that maybe the sample that you choose may not be representative. So in that case, the answer and the accurate prediction will not be there, because if the sample selected is not representing what is actual fact in the population, then the accuracy of survey will go down. That is the inaccuracy. Sometimes people respond, often respond, which they think the researcher wants to hear. So that is one catch in survey as well, that a lot of times whatever the researcher wants to hear, that is what is answered by the survey. Results are useful when respondents are true representative of the universe, that we've already talked about, in the sense that representation of the sample is very important. If it is genuine enough, it will definitely give you good results. Otherwise, it will definitely hamper the study. Let's move on to the next topic, psychological testing. Now, this method is basically very prominent to psychology. We are talking about testing. What are we testing? Various variables. And how are we testing? Through the use of a very objective tool. Now, you must have had a lot of tests published in the newspapers. Test which assess, let's say, your creativity. Test which assess your memory. Test which assess your board results. All of that are the tests which are there. But at the same time, they're not psychological tests, because they are not standardized, they are not objective. Remember these two terms which differentiate psychological tests from the other tests published in the newspapers. Psychological tests are standardized and objective instruments which help in knowing one's standing in comparison to others. So these are the features. When we talk about standardization as such, it basically means uniformity in the conditions of administration. So let's say I develop a test on intelligence, I will prepare a booklet also which will have instruction that every test administrator is going to give. It will have the scores through which I will compile the results. It will have all the other data which I need for my testing. So that is standard. Nobody can change it. It has to be in exactly the same format as the test developer predicts it and decides for it. That is standardization. Uniformity in the conditions of administration, including the test instructions, procedure, manual, that is the booklet, the way it is scored, the time limit, all of that is fixed. Nobody can change it. That is done and developed through a process of research. That is how standardization happens. Standardization has three important parts: reliability, validity, and norms. If I develop a test, it has to be trustworthy. The scores that I get today and the scores that I get after 6 months of testing, if the scores vary, not within a margin of error, then I cannot bank upon the test. That is reliability. So this is test retest reliability. I test it once, after a gap I test it again, then if I get same results within a margin of error, my test is definitely reliable. Second kind of reliability is split half reliability. Now, split half reliability basically means that when you are administering the test, you are not administering it twice, but once you get the results, then you split the test into two parts based on some criteria. It could be odd even criteria. So that means I'm choosing item 1, item 3, item 5, 2, 4, 6. I split them and see the impact. So this, I presume that the impact on odd items and the impact on even items, this is what I'm testing through the reliability. Next is validity. If I say that I'm developing a test which measures intelligence, and when I check the questions, it actually measures English language, so is it a valid test? That is validity. I am saying it measures this, it actually measures this according to research. That is validity. Norms is basically your scoring and your results. So average performance standards of a group, which are used for comparing the performance of an individual of some other group. It gives you a frame of reference, it gives you scores and numbers so that you can compare the scores with that of the other group. if I am testing myself on personality, I will do the test, I will look at the scoring, and the numbers that I get, those numbers will tell me where do I stand in comparison to the other people, and that is my scoring and result. Second, of course, is objectivity, because every test is supposed to be very objective. It's a scientific method, I do it, somebody else does it, obviously it is very useful. Types of test, we have verbal, non-verbal based on language and performance. So we have language, speaking, written or spoken will be verbal. Non-verbal will have pictures and symbols. Performance will have some manipulations like block designs. Then we have difficulty level, time limit. If time is there, then it is speed. If it is power, it has to be accuracy and it has to be increased order of difficulty. Basis of mode of administration, I can administer the test to one person or a group of people. That is what is about psychological testing. And we also have advantages, disadvantages of different tests, where we talk about a testing is very useful in the sense that it has good advantages of objectivity and reliability. It also has replicability, that anybody can do it and get the same kind of results. That is about the advantages and disadvantages. Along with psychological testing, a method which is unique to psychology and used exclusively for psychological research is known as case study. Now, it seems very fascinating as a method. Case is being studied. What kind of case? How is it being studied? What are the advantages of it? All of this will be understood in this topic. Now, a lot of you will be very fascinated by taking up different kind of cases. Somebody might be doing a case study on, let's say, Bhagavad Gita, understanding different scriptures. Another person might be doing it on historical figures. We can do it on a person who is perfectly normal, not having any problem. We can study him as an inspiration also. We can study a case which is very unique. Let's say I'm trying to study three creative writers. I'm trying to understand their commonality. I'm trying to study a particular MNC and its functioning. That is my case. I can also try and study a case which is something different, something unique, something special which I need to understand, like a mental illness, a child suffering from mental retardation called mentally challenged. I'm trying to study that child. It could also be a case of depression. So I'm trying to understand why the person is having depression, what were the factors which resulted in it, how is it being cured, will it occur or reoccur, will it not reoccur, and all of that. That is a case. So case study is basically providing a very detailed knowledge of a particular case. I can take any case like we've discussed. There is no range. It can be normal, it can be different and special, it can be a group also. That is a case study where I can use basically different methods. So under one case study, there can be multiple methods that can be there. For instance, I can interview the cases. For instance, I can give a questionnaire to the cases to fill up. I can do any test, any psychological test on the cases also. At the same time, cases can, so they can fall into different kind of parameters where case is studied in its totality, in detail, over a period of time. So it's over a lot of time that a particular case is studied. Now, let's look at the advantages and disadvantages. It is rich in information, and of course unique cases are provided. It is basically, if I am taking one case and studying that case for 10 years, obviously I'll get so much of a data, which is very useful. That is why it is rich in information. It also provides detailed analysis. It gives valuable research, especially for clinical psychology, where patients are studied in clinics, patients' detailed histories are taken. In-depth study and multiple strategies, again, an advantage. Disadvantage, it cannot be generalized because it is only few cases, and obviously you cannot continue that case. Maybe something happens and you cannot continue. That is a disadvantage of a case study. So today we've covered psychological testing, survey research, and case study method. Thank you.